Steam Deck 2 is coming. I mean, we already knew that, but Valve has once again confirmed that the Steam Deck is a multi-generational product, meaning that they will eventually create a Steam Deck 2, and that they are in fact in it for the long haul. More Steam Decks, more Steam OS. These are the words that Valve put in one of the pages in their brand new book about the Steam Deck. Today, we talk about that book, Valve ramping up production yet again, the future of Switch and Wii U emulation on PC, a new mobile app for Steam, and a huge update to Lutris, as well as an absolutely awesome community spotlight. You'll see. As we get started, folks, if you enjoy my videos, go ahead and drop a like for this one. And if you're still unsubscribed, then hit that button too. What's good, Deck Gang? So, as you likely know, the Steam Deck is launching in a few Asian markets, and in preparation for that, they've made a 50-page booklet to introduce their new customers to Valve, Steam, and the Steam Deck. Although we already know a lot about what's in here, it's still fascinating to review, especially because it provides some perspective on what Valve thinks is important to communicate to new consumers. As they said in their blog post, this booklet contains background on Valve and their philosophy around creating products and hardware to make their customers happy. There are a few high points in this book that I want to touch on, but Steam Deck HQ already compiled highlights on their website, so I figured we'd use that as our guide. If you're unfamiliar with Steam Deck HQ, this is a website and Twitter account dedicated to Steam Deck performance reviews, guides, news, and more. Another Dexpert, if you will. Check the description for links to the website and the Twitter account. So yeah, let's talk about those high points. Number 1, Valve wants you to experiment with your Steam Deck. In fact, my favorite line in the whole book is this one, quote, "Our hardware is designed to enable you to do things we haven't thought of yet," end quote. In the first 6 months, we have already seen so many ways to alter the look, feel, and functionality of the Steam Deck. Of course, that's because it's a PC, but it goes beyond that. This PC also has a large community dedicated to a single specification of hardware, and that community is only getting larger and more capable by the day. If you don't believe me, make sure to check out the community spotlight at the end of this video. Number 2, the iterations of the Steam Deck. Page 23 is entirely dedicated to all the iterations of a portable PC. They really tried everything. There are circular trackpads, square trackpads, and no trackpads. There are normal D-pads and Joy-Con style D-pads. Thank goodness we didn't get those. Some proto decks put the focus on trackpads, others may favor the D-pads or analogs. Some of them even have dockable controls like the Switch. They even show iterations of the PCB and the overall silhouette of the device. It's great to see these various phases, and it goes to show that they didn't rush to market here. Valve tested all of these variables to make sure this thing works for the widest variety of human beings possible. And speaking of not rushing to market, Number 3, the idea of the Steam Deck started 10 years ago. On page 25, Valve states that they've been thinking about the Steam Deck ever since they started working on the Steam controller. Some of the hardcore Valve faithful among you may remember the leaked mockup of the Steam controller that had a screen in the middle. Well, here's Lawrence Yang from Valve talking specifically about that screen and what the team were thinking back then.
When they were iterating and prototyping and thinking about the Steam controller, there was actually a version of the prototype for a while that had a screen in the center. And they're like, this would be really cool if you could just play the games with a controller and just have a handheld thing. And everyone's like, yeah, that's cool. That's impossible right now. We can't do it. There's so much just systems and infrastructure and technology and everything that would just make it very, very hard to do.
That clip, by the way, is from a recent episode of the Friends Per Second podcast where they interviewed Lawrence Yang. Number 4, they learn from past hardware in different ways. Given the long journey from Steam controller to Steam Deck, Valve was able to gain a lot of learnings in creating different hardware. They started with the Steam controller, followed up with Steam Link, partnered with others for Steam machines, and then created the Valve Index. Each of these informed the design, manufacturing, distribution, and support of the Steam Deck. Number 5, Valve wants any PC to take advantage of Steam OS. Valve says that they made the decision for the Steam Deck to run with Steam OS rather than Windows, quote, in order to optimize the Steam Deck experience in many ways specifically for gaming, end quote. I see that design philosophy pretty clearly with the Steam Deck. In 2008, they may have been more worried with Microsoft's growing monopoly, but in 2022, they're also concerned with a streamlined user experience for PC gaming. In any case, we've been waiting for general Steam OS 3 since before the launch of the Steam Deck, and with regard to that, here's what they had to say. say, quote, "We'll soon be shipping a general installer for SteamOS, enabling any PC to take advantage of all of its features. In addition, we'll soon be making SteamOS available for other manufacturers who wish to make a gaming device of their own," end quote. Number 6, the Steam Deck's controller design. As I mentioned with the iterations of the Steam Deck, Valve took a lot of care to ensure that the design of the controller aspects of the Steam Deck could be as pleasing as possible to as wide of an audience as possible, from Western audiences to East Asian audiences. They even show this device here that helped them quickly test different positions and angles. Here's a clip of them talking about it in another interview.
"And this tool was really interesting for us because we could make it wider or narrower, because at that time we still hadn't fixed on the display size either. But depending on the width of the display, it really changes the angle of your wrists and how you hold it, which also changes your mobility of your thumb, right? And which also changes like how to access this. So all these little plates can move, and we can move them in and out."
Number 7, Valve are phasing out Big Picture Mode. Or more specifically, the current Steam Deck interface is what the desktop Big Picture Mode will look like very soon. Like much of the rest of this book, many of us already knew this, but it was good to get that reiteration from Valve here. Last week I showcased a demo of the new improved Flickstick and why it's so much better now than it was before. Well, it's not quite as good in the current version of Big Picture Mode because I can't precisely set the sensitivity, which is very important for Flickstick. Instead, I have to use a slider or dig in some config files. So yeah, I can't wait for the Deck UI to come to Big Picture Mode. Finally, number 8, Steam Deck is multi-generational. Page 51 is where you find the quote that tells us what the future holds. More Steam Decks, more SteamOS. Here, Valve confirms that this is a multi-generational line. They say, quote, "Valve will support Steam Deck and SteamOS well into the foreseeable future. We will learn from the Steam community about new uses for our hardware that we haven't even thought of yet. And we will build new versions to be even more open and capable than the first version of Steam Deck has been," end quote. And yeah, we've heard all the jokes about Valve not being able to count to 3, but we also know that SteamOS has made it to 3. I think this book made it clear that this is where Valve has been headed for the last 10 years, and they're not looking to stop now. They're learning from their mistakes and pressing forward, and I think that's great to see. Finally, they ask, what would you like to see in a future version of a Steam Deck? I asked the same question of you in a community post, and y'all had some great answers. The top comment on that post is a very comprehensive one. Travis Tamaro says, an LTE 5G option, an OLED or AMOLED display that can get brighter than what we have now, smaller bezels, hall-based sticks and triggers, adjustable actuation on those triggers, a dust cover for the microSD card slot, a second USB-C port on the bottom, a bigger battery, even if it makes the device heavier, and finally, continued improvement on SteamOS. I love that. Even beyond this answer, there were a ton of creative responses in there. But what do you think? What would you like to see in a future version of the Steam Deck? Share your thoughts in the comments down below. Next up, Valve say that they are ramping up production yet again. If you were in Q4, there's a chance that you got moved up to Q3. I know one person that placed a 64GB reservation in late April and now has a Q3 ETA. If you were Q4, be sure to log in and check on your ETA. Some people have been expressing doubts that Valve are actually ramping up production at all and have been saying that they're able to move up the timeline faster simply due to interest slowing down after launch, and I guess Valve has been hearing some of that naysaying sentiment and decided to counter that as well. After giving us the good news about ramping up production, they went on to tweet the following, quote, "Another fun stat, the number of Steam Deck reservations being made on a daily basis continues to grow and is at its highest since our launch earlier this year," end quote. Mind you, that's something that I've assumed based on like the growing viewership of this channel, but that's anecdotal and we didn't have any hard evidence. In fact, if you go by something like the Steam Deck subreddit survey, you might think that interest is somewhat waning. As a reminder, this is a survey that you might only fill out if you're already in the subreddit or some other Steam Deck superfan community. It made a lot of sense to reference this data pre-launch, but I think at this point it's no longer a representative sample. So given that, it's good to hear from Valve that interest is actually growing and that they are nonetheless able to get Steam Decks in the hands of more folks. With that knowledge, my friends, again, be sure to check on your ETA to see if you're now in Q3. Moving on, I have two unrelated but interesting stories in the world of emulation. I'll start with the bad news. The first story is that Denuvo DRM is coming to Switch games. The cybersecurity company Irdeto issued a press release earlier in the week that announced their product Anuvo would be used to prevent Switch piracy and, in their own words, unauthorized emulation. They stopped just shy of conflating emulation with piracy, but did not hesitate to throw the word emulation in every time they used the word piracy. To me, the press release almost seems more concerned with emulation than piracy on modded Switches, but that's just pure speculation. Nevertheless, how will this DRM affect legitimate owners of Switch software? Denuvo DRM has been known to affect performance on PC games, and Switch games just cannot afford dips in performance. Moreover, Denuvo is online DRM and Switch is a portable system. How will this impact that experience? And honestly, what does Nintendo gain from this? They piss off hardworking consumers to slightly delay a small group of people from emulating and maybe pirating. If history is any indication, Denuvo DRM will still be cracked, and the people playing the cracked ROMs will have a better experience than those playing on a stock Switch. I expect this to be an annoying speed bump for those that are emulating the Switch, but that's about it. And the last thing I'll say on the subject is this. I'm not sure why Nintendo would be investing such a large effort to curtail piracy unless they think they have a few great years left with the Switch. This seems very out of touch with consumer sentiment. People are chomping at the bit for Switch 2 news at this point, and Nintendo is more focused on this. Anyway, the good news is that the Wii U emulator, Cemu, has now gone open source. We've known this was coming for some time, but it's here, and you can find the source code over on GitHub. This news came about a week ago, and if you go to the GitHub page, you can see that there's already a release for Cemu 2.0, and in fact, it includes an Ubuntu release. So yes, this repo now builds on Linux, and there are Linux releases in the wild. That said, according to the good folks over on the EmuDeck Discord, it's not yet better than playing the Windows build on Steam Deck, so EmuDeck will continue to provide the Windows build until that changes. However, this is amazing news, and it'll be great to see progress now with anyone being able to contribute to this emulator. Open source for the win. Here's a short story for the people that have been watching this channel for a long time. Almost a year ago, I reported on Valve working on a QR login feature that would make it easier to log into Steam since you wouldn't need to enter your password and Steam Guard. This was found by SteamDB founder The XPaw, and we all kind of figured it was designed in mind for the Steam Deck and would launch around the same time. Well, now it's finally here. Well, almost. Valve released a beta version of their mobile app. If you're on iOS, you can try to sign up for this beta via test flight. I'll include a link with instructions in the description. Anyway, this beta contains the QR login feature. I thought it was pretty cool that we finally get to close the loop on that. Otherwise, the redesign for this mobile app is looking good. The new app doesn't have chat built in, but I don't think they'll be adding that back in. I think you have to stick to the standalone Steam chat app for messaging. Next, let's talk about the huge update to Lutris. So Lutris is an application that helps you play non-Steam games. I haven't used it too much so far because it wasn't a flat pack and because I was happy with Heroic Game Launcher for Epic and GOG games. Well, this latest update gives me more reason to use it. First, it's now a flat pack so you can easily install it from the Discover store. Secondly, it has added integration with Amazon Games, which was one of the last major libraries I was missing on the Steam Deck. If you didn't know, Amazon Prime comes with free games every single month that you can redeem on their website and play using their Windows-only launcher. Up until now, the process of getting these games running on the Steam Deck has been pretty cumbersome at best, but now you can install these games from the Lutris launcher. I'll publish a short video showing you how to do that, so look out for that. The only problem with this so far is that there's no brain-dead easy way to add a non-Steam game from here to Steam. You have to find the executable and add it manually. A bit of a pain, but I got there eventually. Alright guys, in lieu of my normal What's on Deck segment, I just want to tell you about this one story that my friend Popo posted on the Fan to Deck Discord, and this one's a hard one, I'm not gonna lie. So yeah, here's the deal. There are two awesome games that just went free on Steam. Waves and Waves 2 are really, really good twin stick shooters that are very much in the vein of Geometry Wars. Waves 2 in particular has been in development for some time in an early access status since 2015 by developer Squid in a Box, whose real name is Rob. Sadly, Rob's partner CJ revealed to the game's Steam community that Rob passed away from cancer complications a few weeks ago, and as a result, they were making both of these games free. Here's a small excerpt from that post. Quote, Rob was very passionate about their work and ever so dedicated. Over the years we were together, they were always dreaming big and trying so hard to create the best game they could possibly make. This did mean that sometimes Rob would shoot for the moon and miss, and it does mean that unfortunately, Waves 2 will definitely remain incomplete. I know they would have liked to have completed the final project, but as COVID encroached, the need to have a more stable income was looming, and between these factors and Rob's struggles with their health, they never got the time to cap off this particular branch of their legacy." End quote. Well, despite the early access date of Waves 2, the work that was done on that game is phenomenal and well worth a look. Rob may not have gotten to finish this final work the way that they wanted to, but that doesn't make this work any less worth playing. If you're looking to play Waves 2 on a Steam Deck, just make sure to force Proton compatibility and it should play just fine. Outside of that, fuck cancer. Alright Deck Gang, let's not end on that summer note, and instead, let's talk about some community spotlights that I'm very excited to share with you. The first one was shared with me by Jake on Discord, and it was first posted to the Steam Deck subreddit by OccamCS. The big news here is that Remote Play Whatever Together now has an app image. So as you may know by now, Steam Deck has a feature called Remote Play Together that allows you to take your offline multiplayer games and play them online with friends on Steam. However, that feature only shows up for games that have been approved for Remote Play Together, even though it works with basically any game, including non-Steam games like emulators. So now there is an app called Remote Play Whatever Together that just became much easier to install since it's now available via an app image. I'm including a link with the instructions on how to use this down in the description. Okay, next, I've shared some dual screen gameplay before, but hey, it's blowing up again, so why not share it again? This one comes from GameXData on Twitter, showing off 3DS gameplay with a second screen on the Steam Deck. Of course, you need to launch Citra in desktop mode to accomplish this, but it is cool nonetheless. If you're looking for a guide on how to do this, check the link in the description. And finally, I geeked out a bit when I saw this one. Shout out to Inspiratus, who shared it with me on Twitter. So this Reddit post comes from Wood as a Riddle, and it asks a really good question about hardware acceleration in Chrome, since that can help save the battery life for watching videos. Anyway, the question got answered by none other than Anthony from LTT. He shares the flags that he set in his Chrome config file and how to verify that it's working. I just thought that was pretty neat. It's Anthony. Once again, the link is in the description. And that's it for this week's roundup. We are entering the last month of Q3, and I have a lot of exciting stuff planned for the next few weeks, so make sure to subscribe and hit the notification bell. And don't forget, these videos are sponsored by the lovely folks over at my Patreon. Deck Gang out. Goodbye!